We're here today to answer the question, can you beat Monster Hunter World without hitting monsters? I've seen plenty of videos with similar challenge run concepts, such as beating the game without sharpening, but I want to push the restrictions far enough that if I can beat this challenge, then the answer to almost any other challenge run restricting damage has to be yes. So let's get it done. What does not hitting the monster mean, and what are the rules for this challenge? The victory condition is to successfully kill Xenogiva. My restrictions include that first and foremost, I cannot damage the monsters with my weapon. This includes things like Kinsects, as they are actively part of the Insectlaze moveset. I am also not allowed to bomb monsters with any kind of barrel or bounce bomb. I am not allowed to use the Clutch Claw or Guardian Armor, no mods, and no co-op or other players helping me. The goal of this run is to maximize the use of environmental traps and components, grimalkins, rarely used and odd items and mechanics, and other such oddities. The most consistent form of damage, though certainly not the highest, is my Palico. But while it's totally possible to make your Palico a badass in the late game, is that really something that can be done as early as the first quest? There's really only one way to find out. As an added rule, there is one exception to my ban of hitting monsters with my weapon, and that's to trigger a Grimalkin Ivy trap after allying yourselves and raising unity with the Grimalkin tribes. They will often lay ivy traps for the monster to get caught into, however, to trigger them, you need to mount the monster near the tribes. Although this technically breaks the rules, I am allowing it only because it keeps within the theme of utilizing the environment. If I am next to a Grimalkin trap and am told to do so, I may do jump attacks necessary to mount the monster, but cannot stab him with my knife or do the mounting finisher, and can only hang on until I run out of stamina or trigger the trap. I am allowed to use the Slinger to directly damage the monsters, but try to keep it to a minimum, with the notable exception of dropped pods as the monster takes damage. Otherwise, generally keeping it to finish off monsters that are at one health, breaking parts, or antagonizing them to attack me. With that out of the way, I make my characters Mantra Man and the cat who will play the game for us, Chad McMillis. After making it through the starting tutorials, without being given access to the smithy, we are tasked with hunting 7 Jagras in the area. Upon checking my Palico stats, he has... he is weak! And not just a little weak, he's weaker than your dad's conviction when he says he'll be back with the milk. But I mean, weapons have bloated values, so maybe the Palicos do too and they're just negative? Or maybe the motion value makes up for these crappy bases, or maybe this may have been a mistake, and I have made a serious lapse in judgment. But there's nothing I can do about it, because much like Logan Paul, I'm already here, and nothing's gonna stop me from plunging into that forest.
That's so bad, why would you write that?
Okay, so the damage of my cat isn't that bad. Even though I can't hit the monster with my weapon, it doesn't mean I can't use weapons at all. Notably, the primary weapon I have equipped throughout the run is the Hunting Horn, because I can use it to provide buffs to my Palico and any allies we pick up. By using the metal bagpipe, I get access to attack up and defense up small, which on court's a large. Attack up large is nothing to scoff at, that's 15%! So, adding 15% to 2 base damage gives me, still 2. Well, to be fair, I can't actually see the damage numbers my cat does to the monster, so maybe the game was generous enough to round it to 3 before the motion values, but I'm not really sure. Either way, it makes me feel like I'm contributing something to the hunt and keeps me from quitting, which is important because it takes me 41 minutes to kill 7 Jagras.
Oh god, please kill me now!
So the cat's damage is, not great at all. This is compounded when he is switching between multiple targets, and there's a lot of Jagras in that cave. Okay, so look, this doesn't look super good right now, I'm not gonna lie. I have no idea whether I can even make it past Great Jagras without machine gunning him with Red Pit myself for half an hour, and I'd prefer to avoid that. We have very little access to tools and upgrades right now, and it shows, and it hurts. But currently, the only thing I can do is try to power my way through it. But there's good news. Now that we've completed this quest, we have access to the smithy. Now, Palico armor and weapons don't upgrade like ours, so instead all of our stat upgrades come from switching to different pieces of gear entirely. And oh look, there's something we can forge now. Let's see its stats! This is my life now. So I have virtually no raised power going into the Castodon Kerfluffle and Great Jagger's quest. Great. My worry over the possibility of this challenge is increasing, but I go for it anyways. Much to my surprise, the Castodon quest turned out to be just a wee bit shorter than the Jagger's one, thanks to a new tool and mechanic that we get to use at our disposal, Torch Bombs. You can use these over at the shoreline, where the second Castodon pack is. And truth be told, I didn't even know Torch Pods spawned in the Ancient Forest. But they are excellent! Torch Pods are one of the most underutilized slinger ammos. They can dispel the effluvium, which is what most people know them for. But they can also start small fires on the ground. And in this game, small monsters are afraid of fire, and shooting a Torch Pod on the ground will make any small monsters nearby become stressed and stand in one place trying to put out the fire by shouting at it. And this gives my cat more opportunities to attack because the monsters aren't hitting him as often and causing him to stagger. Thus, despite being far more hard-headed than the Great Jagger's, the Castodon went down 6 minutes faster, only taking 35 minutes for my Palico to kill. Jesus fucking Christ. And now it's time for one of the hardest quests in the entire run, Great Jagger's. And no, I am not kidding. There are 4 big walls in this challenge run, and Great Jagger's is one of them. You see, this early in the game will not let you embark on expeditions, which are required in order to ally yourselves with the various Linians. As such, I am once again restricted to my cat and whatever I can find in the environment. And while normally this is fine, Great Jagger's does not normally, or only rarely, patrol areas with environmental hazards, such as poison cups or boulders. In fact, the only thing he'll go near in any of my attempts of this run is this vine trap, which is still dependent on my cat to get any actual damage out of it. And speaking of, let's talk about Chad again. You see, low damage isn't his only problem, it's also his AI. In his current state, he truly embodies the word pussy in more than one definition. He's not just a feline, he is scared to get his hands dirty. I would work my ass off to get monsters knocked over and stuck in traps, and my cat would often reward my efforts by being useless. It takes me a long time before I can figure out how to subtly manipulate his AI to be more aggressive, and there's a couple different methods you can employ to do so. But for now, I start attacking thin air, which I think prompts my cat to be more aggressive? It could be placebo, I'm not really sure, but I like to believe it works. I also have to take care not to be damaged because my Palico is equipped with the Vigor Wasp spray, and taking damage will cause him to do that and therefore lower his damage output. But all these factors compound into one hell of a hard quest where I am genuinely not certain if I have enough damage to beat the 50-minute time limit without just ransacking him with Red Pit and Scatternut. Made even worse by the fact that Great Jagger's runs like a bitch when he starts limping. This animal just refused to fight me after a while, and it was torture. In the end, my suspicions were correct, and I lacked the damage to do the job. We failed our first large monster hunt to Great Jagger's via timeouts. For a brief moment, I thought this challenge might be impossible. I know there's upgrades almost immediately after this monster that will make everything much easier, but it seems like I can't get to that point in the first place. Then, an idea strikes me. You see, there's one other armor set I can make this early in the game. Since Fatalis, the game has permanently been on festival mode so as to enable all event quests in the game, and constantly cycles between the various festivals. It just so happens that the one currently happening at the time of recording was the Appreciation Festival, and part of the benefits of this appreciation ticket CD that you gain as login bonuses every day is to craft the event gear. I looked at the stats on this piece of Palico gear, and yo, that's a lot higher! going from 2 to 18 attack looks almost like a 10 times damage increase. The problem is that it requires a light crystal in addition to the appreciation ticket, which, after a quick Google search, have only a 3% drop chance on low rank mining outcrops in the ancient forest. As such, my second attempt at Great Jagras was a bunch of me ignoring the monster and chasing mining outcrops until fortune finally smiled upon me after 20-something minutes, and I found what I was looking for.
Oh, beautiful.
And now, with this damage upgrade, I was finally able to give Great Jagras a run for his money on the now third attempt at his quest, doing much more damage, presumably, while still dealing with unaggressive cat AI, zero environmental damage available to me, and the absolute cuck that is Great Jagras' AI when he's limping. He refused to fight and just runs away over and over, and unless I am in combat, my cat won't attack, and that's a big problem. As an added note, unless it's from a Palico gadget, your Palico cannot break monster parts, and even with a gadget, your Palico cannot finish off large monsters at all. This game requires the hunter to land the final hit to slay monsters. But since all I have going for me is this logo when the monster is near death, it's possible for it to just be chilling at 1 HP and taking a beating from my cat for several minutes and still be alive until I wonder if he's at 1 HP yet and suddenly kill him with a rock. Which is just another compounding problem this early on when I don't have the materials needed to capture. All in all, we were just barely able to kill Great Jagras in our third attempt at an astonishing time of 48 minutes and 30 seconds. Only a minute and a half left. Good fucking lord. But now he's dead! And our next quest is Kuliyaku, which means I've finally unlocked expeditions. First thing I did before the cutscene is run around the entire ancient forest and collect doodles, leading me to the bug trappers, enabling me to ally myself with them. This allows me to request aid from them as tail raiders and have one join my party whenever I spot them on the map, as well as give me access to the flashlight cage tool, which is a new way I can make my cat less likely to be hit and therefore more likely to attack. This also gives my cat the ability to train Jagras, giving me yet another ally on the team. With this boost, it was time to fight Kuliyaku. It was here that I learned just how much value the Linians add to your party. In exchange for not being able to heal on their own, the Linian stats are jacked, and they have clearly more HP defense and attack than my Palico. They also have level 10 upgrades on their native tool, which means that this early on, the Bug Trapper Tail Raiders are able to place shock traps that my cat doesn't have access to yet. Thanks to their help, we were able to take down Kulu in a much more manageable 35 minutes. Now that is an improvement. 35 minutes would remain the average hunt time for the rest of low rank, even as HP pools went up, as almost every monster after Kulu was captured instead of killed to save time. I still didn't have supplies I needed for Trank bombs yet, but I could buy Trank ammo from the provision stockpile and switch to a light bowgun when it was time to capture. I did ensure in the training arena that the Trank ammo does zero damage and it wouldn't be breaking the rules. Puke goes down much the same, but with the notable help of poison cups. And so did Baroth in the Wildspire Waste. Now allying with the Linians in the Waste, the Protectors gives my cat a shield and enables him to attract monsters. This is not something I actively desire on my own cat, since he can't damage the monsters while doing so, but I still need to ally with them so I can recruit them to help me out on my quests, so the adventure begins. After attaining enough doodles and going to the Protector hideout, we are tasked with roofying and kidnapping innocent kittens around the map to recruits into the Protector's cult. Mission accomplished. Just gotta make sure the guild doesn't find out their star hunter is going into the trafficking business. Giratotus goes down easy, and it's time to move on. Toby Kodachi is also no challenge, mostly. And now I have access to the botanist to grow me all the weed and shrooms I will ever need. It's around here that I finally unlocked the ability to order my cat to place flashlight cages using the whistle command from my items. This turned out to be important, as I can do it whenever my cat is hanging back and doing nothing to force it into action, allowing me to manipulate its AI to be more aggressive slightly. I forgot to record Anjanath, but he wasn't noteworthy at all, and it's on to Zoramagros! Woo! The start of the quest is pretty standard, but as I got to Zora's shell, a sudden question popped into my head. Wait, where's Chad? Wait a moment, the game doesn't even allow the cat onto Zora's shell at all? Forget the magma cores, how do I repel Nergigante and complete the quest? Is this the end of the challenge run already? Could my pet cat really be bested by something so weak, inconsequential, and non-dangerous as lava? I had no choice but to just see how it goes. With nothing I could do, I just mined and stood around for a while. You know, this quest goes notably faster when you don't kill the magma cores. Nergigante's appearance is tied to how far Zora walks, and he walks a lot faster when you're not interrupting his cycle to destroy cores. If you don't care about high-ranked Zora gear, this is a great way to expedite the quest and get it done faster. I swear, this is the fastest run-through of this quest I've ever done. It might also be that by this point I was used to long hunts and being patient, and that warped my perspective, but I'm not really sure. Then the moment I was fearing arrived, and Nergigante showed up, requiring me to repel him to complete the quest. And what's this? My cat's here? Why is he allowed to be on Zora's shell for Nergigante but nothing else? I'm so confused. But in any case, it seems my run isn't dead just yet, even if I am on the inside. Just a little perseverance and Zora is complete! Woo! Now with Zora passed, we get access to the Coral Highlands, and that means more Linians. In order to ally with the troopers, we need to follow the teachings of American colonialism, purposely put ourselves in a position where we will be attacked so we can relocate the natives in the name of self-defense, make peace with them by doing something they want, and in exchange, all they have to do is subjugate themselves to me and fight for me whenever I call upon them. The new tool we get, the Coral Cheerhorn, is better for a solo Palico than the shield. It can actually increase the attack and defense stat when we're lucky. However, the damage simply cannot compete with the massive amount of damage openings we get by using the mass flashfly cage and shock traps. It is, however, extremely useful as a Tail Raider ability when I get an extra Palico to help me out with it. Petaluma got deflated, and then it was time to go to the Vale. And you know what a new area means. New Linians! Nope, I guess not. Yeah, unfortunately, we have to wait all the way until we've seen the Odogaron cutscene before we unlock the portion of the map containing the Plunderer hideout and enable us to ally with them. But it is here that we meet our second of four walls in this playthrough. And that's Rotobon! Rotobon is tricky because he's covered in bone armor that greatly lowers the damage done to it, and I have to guess when they are at the breaking point and shoot them with slinger ammo to get a break on the armor so my cat can do full damage. He's also just got a lot of health. This is a quest I was worried about, so I intended to fight Rotobon in the first interaction with him during the story expedition when I have no time limit. It turns out this would be a huge mistake, because although I don't have a time limit in expeditions, the monsters do. I assumed that Rotobon would stay forever due to him being the intended kill to progress the story as long as I stayed inside the assigned expedition and not my own normal expeditions. It turns out this would be inaccurate. Do you see this pop-up on the right side of my screen? Well, I didn't, and Rotobon ran away at the exact same time and location that a new Rotobon spawned on the map while I was chasing, resulting in me fighting a completely fresh and full HP Rotobon without realizing it, and without the help of falling bones since they were all used up on the first one. Combined with the pitiful damage thanks to the bone armor, and this second Rotobon crushed my soul. As it left the locale as well, after I thought I hammered away on it for like an entire hour. Ugh. But all was not lost, however, as the Rotobon grind had finally leveled up my flashfly enough for my cat to create boom bug traps. I got that boom, 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 that future boom, 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 let me get it now. Which are outstanding. outstanding, as much like barrel bombs, they do high, consistent damage regardless of monster defense, but also don't violate the rules like bombs do. They cannot be boosted by the Bombardier skill, but now armed with a consistent way to get around Radaban's tough armor, we were able to scale the second wall without too much issue on our first attempt at the Radaban quest, and overall our third Radaban. This bomb allows us to frankly trounce the rest of low rank. Though as a side benefit, when we hit Odogron, we finally get to ally ourselves with the Plunderers. This involves scaring them away from their food source, and then forcing them to become dependent on me for any scraps of food I deign to leave them. Subjugation complete. The Plunderblade is neatish. It actually involves doing damage to the monsters, which is cool. But I can't see the damage numbers, and don't imagine it's high, and the occasional extra red pods of Stinger ammo you get out of it are not worth it when compared to the... we just did it for the ability to train Gyros and attain Tail Raider help, really. Odogron, Legiana, and Rathalos, who I forgot to record, and Diablos all bowed to the king, and it was time for our rematch with Zora. This time, my cat isn't even allowed for the repel, but you don't actually have to do anything to repel Nurgi for this quest. People often assume that he leaves on his own when he feels like it, but in fact, he actually leaves on his own without you engaging him because Zora keeps sniping him with lava explosions and repels Nergigante for you, which is crazy to me, but that's actually how it works, believe it or not. This works all the way up until Arc Tempered, where you are forced to actually get in there and do some damage to progress the quest. In any case, it's on to high rank, because that was easy. The Puke Puke quest marks the first time in this run I get triple carded, though not from Puke itself. No, that would be far too reasonable and normal. Instead, I get pranked by this game so hard it could be on Tosh.0. I die in the expedition to Kajalaka two-shotting me with Molotovs. Then I remembered my trauma with Radaban and left the expedition to pursue Puke in quest format instead. This gave Basil a chance to spawn and do what he does best. And then I got Puke all the way to where it was limping, but accidentally trapped the Raffian instead. Deciding to just kill Puke instead of going back to get a new trap, I eventually got fireballed by the Raffian. Back at the camp, two feints in, and with Puke capturable still, I grab a fresh trap and make my way over. However, every time I shot the Raffian away with the dung, the Puke would just get scared just before the Raffian left and run away itself, right to the place where Raffian was going. This repeated multiple times of just going back and forth and not being able to capture anything, and just Puke refused to fight me overall. This sucked. And eventually, Raffian just got lucky and fireballed me a second time, causing my fourth cart hunting Puke, none of which were actually to Puke, and my first non-timer-related fail. The cosmic comedy of this hunt is astounding. It truly is. Then I hunt high-rank Great Gyros to make his arms for 2 points in Palico Rally, which combined with my Rally Charm would give us a 15% boost to our Palico's damage. But after an uneventful Pink Raffian comes our third wall, Nergigante. Nergigante is tough because of two reasons. The first is that as an Elder Dragon, he doesn't fall for traps, so the Bomb Bug and Thunder Bug traps from my cat now do nothing. I also can't trap it, and I'm forced to take extra time to finish Nergi off, compound with his much larger HP than anything we've seen so far, and we've got a tough boy ahead of us. The second thing that makes him tricky is that due to traps not being effective, I need to train up a new tool. The only real viable option is the Myaukolov cocktail from the Gajalaka, but I will have trouble leveling this up to a point where I can order my cat to keep it active and engaging without slacking, simply due to the fact that you only get access to the Gajalaka right before Nergigante's quest, which is the first required quest in Elder's Recess. Thus, to prepare for this hunt, I ran around the map collecting Gajalaka traps until I could do the quest, which involves sneaking around Gajalaka while they look the other way during a tribal dance on an expedition at nighttime in the recess. I guess the developers just forgot that you could equip the ghillie mantle, though, because it turns out a 6-foot-tall walking bush is totally normal and not cause for concern at all to the Gajalaka. So we make our way to their hideout and make peace. The Gajalaka are strong and capable warriors, and as such, we will allow them to keep their freedom and rule with us over the rest of the Linnean tribes. Which is a good thing, because these guys are chads, let me tell you. But more importantly, I am taking some time prior to Nergigante to farm Pink Rathian to level the cocktail a little bit while getting the Pink Rathian armor, which I will need later. Set farmed out, it was time to fight the Spiky Boy. Allow me to introduce you to two of my friends, the Gajalaka Knight and the Gajalaka Sniper, who I will exclusively refer to as Soga King from now on. These two Gajalaka Tail Raiders are incredible fighters who do way more damage than my cat. All three cats in discussion are armed with the Myalkalov cocktail, but it scales based off of your Palico's ranged attack stat, and while my cat was doing 80 to 90 on a solid Myalkalov to the head, these two were doing more. Unfortunately, I didn't have any camps unlocked, and Nergigante does a lot of damage. Much of my time this quest was spent running around re-recruiting the fallen Gajalaka to fight arm in arm as my battle brothers, and we fell to timeout just before Nergigante died. So how can we fix this? There are two major areas of improvement we can adjust: preventing the deaths of Soga King, and reducing the amount of time I spend running around the map. This means farming for life powder materials, as well as hunting Barnos and a Dodogama to unlock the two extra camps. Additionally, after the first attempt, my cat had leveled enough to use the final form of the Myalkalov, the Myalkano. This worked like a charm, and Nergigante was soon under my foot as well, though he took by far the largest amount of prep work, including attaining the cocktail, leveling it to level 11, and getting two camp deliveries done. I didn't even lose any Gajalaka this time around. The three life powder I started with was enough to keep Soga King alive during the entire hunt. Like, really, this went really smoothly. Like, Nergigante did not stand a chance once we did some proper prep work. That's three walls down and one wall to go. Kushal is up next, and in addition to the falling boulders that I used against Nergigante, we also get four Nitro Toads and a Paralysis Toad, so, you know, he goes down fast. Same with Teostra. Valhazak takes a little longer, since it takes a place away from the Elder's Recess, meaning no Gajalaka, which means we don't get our presence graced by Soga King, and must instead use our starving plunderer slave workers as cannon fodder instead. But, you know, after having two or three of them die for a cause they don't know, we were finally able to get through that as well. And with this comes the biggest wall on paper, Xenogeta. He has the highest HP count of any monster, little in the way of environmental traps outside of a few boulders, and no Tail Raiders or Linnians to boost my damage. Truly a conundrum. But this is why we've been farming the Pink Rathian material, as my plan is to contribute to damage using poison smoke bombs. The Pink Rathian armor has a set bonus called Poison Duration Up, which doubles the duration and, by extension, the damage of poison. Every monster takes differing amounts of damage from poison, but Xenogeta in particular is critically weak to it, and doubling the damage from Pink Rathian makes every proc of poison do 1,600 whopping damage to Xenogeta, which is overall about 11% of its HP. So we are taking 5 poison smoke bombs, 10 smoke nuts, and 10 toadstools for a total of 15 poison smoke bombs to the fight with us, spamming these in his face until he contracts the coronavirus and dies. That, with my Palico now fully upgraded with the Neocano, is going to put a whole lot of hurt Zeno's way, and despite my fears, this wall was passed in the first attempt in just 30 minutes by using a Farcaster and refilling my toadstools and poison smoke bombs one time in the middle of it. And just like that, the challenge was complete. So can you beat Monster Hunter World without hitting the monster with your weapon, bombing it with bombs, or clutch clawing the monster? Yes. Yes, you can. Should you? Absolutely not. But it's okay. This is all behind us now, and there is absolutely no more content in Monster Hunter World to go through. Please don't make me do it. I will if this blows up, but please don't make me. I've shed enough tears. Okay, that's it. Goodbye.
Mmm, so tasty.